All right, both Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump are spending today preparing for Wednesday's debate. So what can we expect to see in their final face-to-face meeting? Joining me now, Republican strategist Brian Morgenstern and political analyst Ellis Hennigan. All right, gentlemen, good to see you.
Hey, Fred.
All right, so in the past week, we have seen 9 women now come out accusing Donald Trump of sexual misconduct, Hillary Clinton's hacked emails leaked by WikiLeaks, or at least that's what WikiLeaks says, that they are Clinton-related emails, and Donald Trump claiming the election is rigged. So how will each candidate navigate their own issues? Brian, you first.
Oh, boy. Look, Hillary is in the driver's seat at this point. She doesn't have to do much because, like Napoleon said, you know, when your opponent is destroying himself, just let him do it, you know? So she doesn't need to get in the way. For Trump's part, he needs to get some of the negative slime that has been all over him for the last couple of weeks redirected onto her. So, I would expect him to dig pretty deeply into this WikiLeaks stuff. I mean, there were emails about and her speeches where she was cozying up to investment banks, which of course is very unpopular with the left, where she was discussing trade deals and how she favors open trade deals and open borders. That, of course, has been a theme of this election. So,
and again, the Clinton camp hasn't authenticated those emails and that information, nor has CNN, but continue.
Right, but in order to really get control of the reins of this thing and try to get it back on track as much as he can, I would expect him to really be hammering on that stuff.
Ellis, do you see Trump really capitalizing off that, or does he have his own stuff that he needs to address with real clarity first?
He should, but he can't, right? I mean, what we've learned in the last weeks is that he's a man possessed, right? I mean, he's going to beat up on these women, all 9 of them. He's going to ignore the fact that he's confessed to the allegations that they have piled upon him. He'll continue to claim that the election is rigged and that our entire political system is some global conspiracy against Donald Trump. There's no evidence that we have that it'll be anything else. For Hillary's part, she ought to shift over to quit attacking Donald. I mean, there's nothing else she can say really on that, and simply put out a clear message to her supporters and potential supporters about the vision going forward, about the kind of president she'll be. That's the close the deal comments from Hillary.
And both camps know how important it is to clinch the female vote, and that's a very diverse electorate. And both acknowledge and know how important it is to clinch the Latino vote. And we know today Hillary Clinton's running mate Tim Kaine spoke in Spanish, perhaps even making history as the first, you know, vice presidential candidate speaking in entirety in Spanish, campaigning at a church in Florida. In fact, I think we have a sample of that right now.
Good. Buenos días a todos. Estoy bien contento de visitar con ustedes aquí en el Numa Church.
So, Brian, how potentially advantageous might this be for Hillary Clinton, especially when there is so much noise, so to speak, in both camps?
I mean, you know, it helps to speak people's native languages in terms of making a connection. I think it's, you know, that's sort of a cosmetic thing, and it's certainly well below the surface of all the other headlines right now of the allegations against Trump and the WikiLeaks with Clinton. So, it's a nice asset to have. I just don't see that as an element that's going to change the dynamic of this debate or the dynamic of this election in the remaining, however many days you said, 23 days or so left.
Yeah, 23/24 because the clock is ticking in between. Okay, so Ellis, how do you see it?
I mean, you're right. This is not about the veeps, right? I mean, when you have such huge characters at the top of the ballot, I don't think either one of these candidates on the vice presidential level is going to change too much. I assume it's just going to get uglier and it's continue to spiral downward. It'll be not 9 women, it'll be 19 or 39 or something. And the Trump conspiracies playing to the crazed part of the base will just get darker and more apocalyptic. I think that's what we all got for the next 23.
All right.
That is awfully dark. That is awfully dark.
That's real dark and getting darker, guys. Cover your eyes, please.
You want to know the darkest thing? In 23 days, one of these candidates is going to be the president-elect of the United States, and that's going to be our next 4 years. Yikes.
Well, let's hope that people are hopeful about the election process overall, or whatever is to come, gentlemen. All right, we're going to have you back, Brian and Ellis. Appreciate it. Thank you. All right, still ahead, the CNN election bus is heading to a city near you. Our Chris Moody is in Denver today getting voters' thoughts on the election. Chris.
That's right. We've heard from the professional political class and from politicians, but I've spent the past 3 weeks talking to only voters. We'll find out what they have to say about this election up next.
All right, both Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump are spending today preparing for Wednesday's debate. So what can we expect to see in their final face-to-face meeting? Joining me now, Republican strategist Brian Morgenstern and political analyst Ellis Hennigan. All right, gentlemen, good to see you.
Hey, Fred.
All right, so in the past week, we have seen 9 women now come out accusing Donald Trump of sexual misconduct. Hillary Clinton's hacked emails leaked by WikiLeaks, or at least that's what WikiLeaks says, that they are Clinton-related emails. And Donald Trump claiming the election is rigged. So how will each candidate navigate their own issues? Brian, you first.
Oh, boy. Look, Hillary is in the driver's seat at this point. She doesn't have to do much because, like Napoleon said, you know, when your opponent is destroying himself, just let him do it.
You know how important it is to clinch the female vote, and that's a very diverse electorate. And both acknowledge and know how important it is to clinch the Latino vote. And we know today Hillary Clinton's running mate Tim Kaine spoke in Spanish, perhaps even making history as the first, you know, vice presidential candidate speaking in entirety in Spanish, campaigning at a church in Florida. In fact, I think we have a sample of that right now.
Good. Buenos días a todos. Estoy bien contento de visitar con ustedes aquí en el Numa Church.
So, Brian, how potentially advantageous might this be for Hillary Clinton, especially when there is so much noise, so to speak, in both camps?
I mean, you know, it helps to speak people's native languages in terms of making a connection. I think it's, you know, that's sort of a cosmetic thing, and it's certainly well below the surface, you know, so she doesn't need to get in the way. For Trump's part, he needs to get some of the negative slime that has been all over him for the last couple of weeks redirected onto her. So, I would expect him to dig pretty deeply into this WikiLeaks stuff. I mean, there were emails about and her speeches where she was cozying up to investment banks, which of course is very unpopular with the left, where she was discussing trade deals and how she favors open trade deals and open borders. That, of course, has been a theme of this election. So,
and again, the Clinton camp hasn't authenticated those emails and that information, nor has CNN, but continue.
Right, but in order to really get control of the reins of this thing and try to get it back on track as much as he can, I would expect him to really be hammering on that stuff.
So, Ellis,
of all the other headlines right now of the allegations against Trump and the WikiLeaks with Clinton. So, it's a nice asset to have. I just don't see that as an element that's going to change the dynamic of this debate or the dynamic of this election in the remaining. However many days you said, 23 days or so left.
Yeah, 23/24, because the clock is ticking in between. Okay, so Ellis, how do you see it?
I mean, you're right. This is not about the Veeps, right? I mean, when you have such huge characters at the top of the ballot, I don't think either one of these candidates on the vice presidential level is going to change too much. I assume it's just going to get uglier and continue to spiral downward. It'll be not 9 women, it'll be 19 or 39 or something. And the Trump conspiracies playing to the crazed part of the base will just get darker and more apocalyptic. I think that's what.
Do you see Trump really capitalizing off that, or does he have his own stuff that he needs to address with real clarity first?
He should, but he can't, right? I mean, what we've learned in the last weeks is that he's a man possessed, right? I mean, he's going to beat up on these women, all 9 of them. He's going to ignore the fact that he's confessed to the allegations that they have piled upon him. He'll continue to claim that the election is rigged and that our entire political system is some global conspiracy against Donald Trump. There's no evidence that we have that it'll be anything else. For Hillary's part, She ought to shift over to quit attacking Donald. I mean, there's nothing else she can say really on that, and simply put out a clear message to her supporters and potential supporters about the vision going forward, about the kind of president she'll be. That's the close the deal comments from Hillary.
And both camps.